Hachette Audio presents The Immortals, Olympus Bound, Book 1, written by Jordanna Max Brodsky, read by Jordanna Max Brodsky and Robert Petkoff.
For Jason, who believed.
I sing of Artemis, whose shafts are of gold, who cheers on the hounds, the pure maiden, shooter of stags, who delights in archery, own sister to Apollo. Over the shadowy hills and windy peaks she draws her golden bow, rejoicing in the chase, and sends out grievous shafts. And when she is satisfied and has cheered her heart, this huntress hangs up her curved bow and leads the muses in dance, while they sing how neat-ankled Leto bare children supreme among the immortals. Hail to you, children of Zeus and rich-haired Leto. The Homeric Hymn to Artemis, circa 6th century BC.
Chapter 1. Punisher. Selene DiSilva crouched in a narrow alley between two run-down apartment buildings, watching the street. When she'd begun her vigil hours before, the smells of roasting chicken and frying plantains had wafted from the surrounding apartments. Families laughed and bickered, doors slammed, cars honked. But in the small hours of the morning, the only scents were those from the trash cans overflowing nearby, and the street before her lay nearly deserted. Even in the city that never slept, there were quiet corners like this, a forgotten neighborhood perched at Manhattan's northernmost tip. Here, most people obeyed the ancient human instinct to seek refuge from the dark, but not Selene, and not the man she'd been sent to hunt. A single dark SUV rolled by, a wave of Caribbean hip-hop pouring through the open window to briefly shatter the silence. From her hiding place, Selene peered at the driver, but let him pass unmolested. Later, a group of swaggering young men strolled along the street, laughing and shoving as they claimed the sidewalk for themselves. Selene watched them carefully, but didn't move. Then two women passed her alley, speaking in slurred Spanish, their eyes purple with fatigue. She felt no empathy. As usual, she'd slept all day and only awoken with the moonrise. Finally, a solitary figure appeared at the far end of the block. Long before she could see his face, Selene knew him by his stride. Chin forward and shoulders high like he's looking for a fight, she thought, but only with someone he's sure he can beat. She glanced at the apartment building across the street, a wide 1920s facade, its Art Deco grandeur long since gone. A window on the third floor flickered blue behind thin curtains. Jackie Ortiz was awake and watching TV, just as Selene had instructed. She stood up slowly as the man approached the building. Mario Velasquez. Medium height, shorter than her own 6 feet, but broad across the shoulders, his muscles bulkier than hers. He wore a rhinestone-studded cross on a thick gold chain around his neck and kept his hands shoved into the front pocket of his sweatshirt. She couldn't be sure if he was armed or not, but she'd find out soon enough. She could see his face now, the same one she'd been stalking for a week, high cheekbones and a neat goatee, dark skin that made his light blue stare all the more alluring. Once again, she thought, a woman falls for a pair of pretty eyes and never bothers to find out what's behind them. Mario stopped opposite Jackie's building. Looking up at her window, he pulled a cell phone from his pocket. Selene couldn't make out his murmured conversation, but she recognized the aggravation in the rising pitch of his voice. It wouldn't be long before he started throwing punches. She let the tiniest of smiles cross her lips. She was, after all, going to enjoy this. Mario stepped into the building's small vestibule. Through the cloudy glass of the front door, Selene watched him jab repeatedly at the buzzer for Jackie's apartment. Next to him stood a doorman's podium, just for show, Selene knew. No lobby guard would appear to protect Jackie from her boyfriend. Her only defense was a weak lock on the building's inner door and the woman she'd hired to strike Mario down. Selene crossed the street and waited just out of Mario's sight. "Come on, Jackie," she urged silently. "Be brave." The young woman appeared in the vestibule, closing the inner door behind her so that Mario couldn't get upstairs. Selene tensed, ready to spring forward. But not yet. Not yet. Jackie, short and skinny, looked even younger than her 22 years. She'd made a vain attempt to cover her swollen black eye with a smear of turquoise shadow. One hand nervously twirled a lock of dyed blonde hair. She held her other arm across her body like a shield. Mario flashed her a smile and sneaked a quick kiss on her neck. Jackie shuddered. Whether with delight or fear, Selene couldn't tell. Then he took a step closer, and the woman put a hand on his chest, pushing him away. He kept coming, backing her into a corner, still smiling despite Jackie's protests. He rested one hand possessively on her neck and hooked the other around the white leather belt at her waist, pulling her against him. Jackie struggled in his grip, her eyes darting back and forth, searching for Selene. Just a moment more, Selene thought. So the police have evidence. Then it happened, quick as a snake bite. Mario slapped Jackie across the face. Selene yanked open the outer door and put a light hand on Mario's shoulder. Still holding onto Jackie's belt, he turned to the intruder. "Hey, Mario," Selene said with her best attempt at casual courtesy. She didn't want to antagonize him until Jackie was safe. "Who the fuck are you? You don't recognize me?" Selene gave him what she hoped was an alluring smile. His defensiveness dissolved as quickly as it had appeared. He made a low sound of pleasure, like a man savoring some succulent morsel. Jackie slipped from his loosened grip as he turned all of his attention toward Selene. His eyes traveled appreciatively over her body, seeing past her loose cargo pants to the long, lean legs underneath. "If I'd nailed you, I think I'd remember." Unnoticed, Jackie scurried back through the inner door and pulled it shut behind her. "Perhaps," Selene nodded with exaggerated thoughtfulness. "But considering the number of women you're currently sleeping with, perhaps not."
"What do you know about
Lila? Miriam? Fatima?" She ticked them off one by one on her fingers. "Raquel, Yolanda, and of course, Jackie. Although you don't sleep with Jackie so much as beat her up, so I'm not sure I should count her." Mario put his hand in his sweatshirt pocket and didn't draw it back out. "A knife," Selene decided. "Hopefully not a gun."
"You a cop?" he asked.
"Not at the moment."
"Then back away, lady. Mind your own business."
"It's my business to keep you away from her," he smirked.
"And how you gonna do that?"
Selene drilled a right hook into his face, spinning him away, then a left into his kidney. With great satisfaction, she watched a line of bloody spittle drip from his mouth onto the floor as he doubled over. But Mario recovered quickly, coming upright with a long, serrated hunting knife in his hand. He barreled toward her. She sidestepped him easily, thrusting out a foot to send him stumbling forward into the opposite wall. Before he could regain his balance, she jabbed an elbow into his spine, bringing all her superior height to bear. Mario grunted and dropped the knife, but stayed on his feet. Faster than she'd anticipated, he spun toward her and kicked her hard in the knee. Biting back a yelp of pain, she fell, slamming the injured knee into the ground. He kicked again, striking her in the jaw. Her teeth sliced the inside of her cheek. She tasted blood. Cold panic rushed through her veins as a third kick smashed into her ribs, knocking the breath from her body. Vision wavering, she reached across the floor toward the fallen knife. Mario beat her to it, bringing the blade down in a slicing arc toward her face. She moved her head just in time to prevent losing her nose. The knife whistled through the air beside her ear and struck the tiled wall with a sharp ping.
"You're gonna wish you hadn't gotten in my way, puta."
He kicked her backward and kneeled over her body, pinning her in place. For decades, she'd been dreading this moment. The fight she couldn't win.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.